Mic working? Yeah. Okay, busy morning with the breakfast. Okay, so hi everyone again. We're going to have another talk today about use cases, how to build stuff using DPDK, and we'll talk about our recent work that we did in DPDK and FIDO, FT.io. Obviously, we need to make sure that what we create in DPDK and FIDO also works when you try to use it to create more complex stuff. So we'll talk about use cases. The one that we picked is an edge router. So we did some work in DPDK to create an edge router application using pretty much all the components that we have in DPDK. I don't think there is anything significant missing from there. It's a good tool to actually see that everything aligns and works together. And also get a feeling of the usability of DPDK components, libraries, and also get a feeling of the performance and the trade-offs between functionality and performance, how to integrate things, how to make them work together. Then we are currently doing the same thing with enabling the same use case in a VPP on FIDO, FT.io. So that's like, once we have this as well, maybe they will not be identical, but hopefully very similar, we can actually use the two to compare and contrast and see which are the good things in DPDK that maybe we need to push into FIDO, which are the good things in FIDO that we can maybe adopt in DPDK, so on and so forth. Yes. So maybe a couple of words about the use case itself. Maybe it's not news to people. Hopefully it's not news to people. It's an edge router, so basically a router that sits between two networks. We actually focused on the provider edge router, the provider flavor of an edge router. You could obviously have other edge routers, like BNGs, BRACs, customer edge routers, customer premises routers. So maybe differences are not that big in terms of functionality. Okay, maybe sometimes the protocols might be different, but it's basically the same principles, the same functionality. Maybe some of the times, or most of the times, the differences also lie in dimensioning these things, like number of routes, number of flows, type of routes. I mean, we think that this structure is a very good structure and very representative for a big family of edge routers. So, an edge router is your usual device that sits between two networks, adapts between two networks. On one side, typically you have a core network. On the other side, you have an access network. You have basically two functional pipelines here. You have an upstream pipeline and a downstream pipeline. So packets going from customers to the core network on the upstream side, and packets going from core network to the access network on the downstream side. So as I was saying, like, lots of functions built using DPDK libraries. So on the downstream side, you have packet reception, you have routing, traffic management and packet transmission. On the upstream side, we have packet reception, ACL filters, flow classification, then one or two stages of metering and policing and marking, and then you have routing and packet transmission. So maybe a few remarks here. In this instantiation, the packet format that we picked is an MPLS-based core network, so IP packets encapsulated into MPLS frames, so basically IP packets with MPLS tags. On the access network, we have QNQ packets, QNQ IP packets. So on the core network side, MPLS labels are used to switch packets within the core network. On the access side, we have QNQ labels, basically a C VLAN and an S VLAN, service VLAN and customer VLAN. Both of them represent are typically used to identify a customer. So like, it's your customer ID. Routing also also adapts between the two encapsulations. So basically, when packets arrive here on downstream, the MPLS labels are removed from the packet. And then once we do the routing based on IP routing, LPM lookup, basically implementing using the LPM library, we identify a route in the routing table and the next hop details, and the Q and Q labels are actually an attribute of the route. So this is how we get Q and Q labels. It's not an attribute of the output network interface. It's not L2 Q and Q rules that apply, it's L3 Q and Q rules. A traffic manager is your usual five-level hierarchical scheduler from DPDK with levels like output port, support, pipe, traffic classes and queues, packet queues. A bunch of features there, it will take a long while to go through this, it's a different topic. We also have congestion management on the input side, so as packets go into the traffic manager, we could have tail drop or red or W red, weighted red applied there. Packet transmission is obvious. ACL is basically wildcard type of classification. Flow classification is used to identify a flow ID. Based on the flow ID, you get the records for that flow, and you apply the metering stages, one or two stages. You could actually do metering per subscriber or per user. You could also do metering per traffic class of each user. You might have voice or real-time traffic or real-time video or whatever. And you could have best effort traffic, you could have other intermediate priority traffic classes. And it's important to actually apply some metering per traffic class because you have different treatment for voice versus best effort traffic. So typically if you exceed the voice, the allowance for voice, you should probably drop those packets because the service won't be usable. There is no point in sending them with a lower priority. Routing is the same, very similar to the downstream routing. It's just that now we get MPLS labels that we need to apply over the packet, and then packet transmission. So that's an overview of the use case, and now we're going to the implementation side, how we implemented this in DPDK. So Jasminder will walk you through that.
Yeah. So as Christian represented in the last slide, we have upstream and downstream packet processing pipelines. So in this application, we have developed those pipelines using low complexity configuration file, which abstract the low level source code details and allow user enough flexibility in instantiating this application function blocks, configuring them and connecting them to build this pipeline topology. So as we see here, each of the application in this configuration file, each of the application function block is instantiated and represented using a pipeline section. So in this pipeline section, some of the fields are common and mandatory to define the function blocks, and some of the fields are very functionality specific. So for instance, if you take pipeline one, we have type is equal to routing, which belongs to the downstream first function block. And we also define the core CPU thread ID, which is the tuple, basically the socket ID, physical core ID, and hyper thread ID. So with that, define the CPU thread ID, which affinize this functional block to the CPU core where it will run. And then it has a packet transfer interface through which it will connect to the preceding and the succeeding function blocks. And then there are some functionality specific fields which are very specific to this routing. As it is downstream, so we encapsulate the packet into a QNQ format so that it could be accepted into the access network where subscribers are sitting. So these are some of the pipelines. So if you see here, there are some similar fields defined in each pipeline. And if you look at the upstream side, we have some of the fields, like in firewall application, we have packet type. We define the packet type because it accepts the packet from the access network, which are in the QNQ format. So and it applies the firewall rules on the QNQ IP4 packets. And similarly, we have flow classification pipeline. We have some key sizes, key offset. These are very specific to flow classification, which are not defined in anywhere else. Flow action, which takes care of metering. So we have some flow ID offsets, IP header offsets defined as such. So this is the way we construct this application pipeline, and these samples are available as a part of IP pipeline application along with some other small sample applications. So
yeah, maybe what's important to note here is that these configuration files are actually a very simple, hopefully straightforward description language. Obviously, it's not. It doesn't have the complexity of hardware description languages like Verilog. You shouldn't do that, right? That would be a wrong idea. But at the end of the day, what we try to describe, what we try to do here is describe in words a diagram. So this is why we put a diagram on top. That's the visual representation of the text file. We actually do have a Python script in DPDK. Not sure if people noticed that. It's a Python script in this IP pipeline application, and given an input configuration file, you can actually generate the diagram. You can generate these pipelines and the connectivity between them. So basically very similar to the diagram that is on top of the file. So definitely encourage people to actually go and look in the IP pipeline application, look at the edge router downstream and upstream configuration files. See how they work. You could actually do everything that you have in the PDK, starting from L2 forwarding, L3 forwarding, with any type of ports, either a POMO driver or KNI interface or a TAP interface or everything. You can actually do it with just simple configuration files. For example, if you want to change this from a hardware queue to a TAP interface or a KNI interface, you simply say instead of RxQ0.0, which is Q0 of and NIC port 0, you just use KNI 0 or TAP 0. Straightforward. And you get it done. Yeah, okay. So now, I think we want to talk a bit about some of the learnings that we have as part of this process of building the edge router and as part of the process of building the infrastructure of the IP pipeline application. It's actually a lengthy topic. I'll try to keep it short. It might be a separate topic for a separate discussion. So, first of all, let's understand what we have here. So, we have all these pipelines, which we have a library of blocks, like you could look at them as classes in object-oriented programming, modules, right? We call them pipelines. They are a sort of a task. So, basically, it's like an execution item, a task, a thread, call it any word you want. We used to call it pipeline because we created using an open flow type methodology. So we just throw some tables, we connect them together to input and output ports, we define actions, we populate tables. So once we do that, we create all these types of pipelines, classes like firewall and pass-through, which is basically could be used for reception or transmission, could be used for traffic management. So simply cables that adapt from one type of input port to another to an output port of a different type. That's the pass-through pipeline that we use throughout. Routing pipeline, so on and so forth. What these pipelines have in common is that they have a very nice interface from my perspective. So they have a packet interface, these packet queues, and they do have a configuration interface, so these message queues. So why is this important? Because this is actually, the packet queue interface is the one that actually allows you to connect these blocks in any topology. So sometimes people talk about the pipeline model and some people say, oh, this is about the pipeline. Well, it is a pipeline because any application functionally is a pipeline. It's a pipeline of interconnected functional blocks. You have to do packet reception before you do classification, before you do metering, so on and so forth. So there is a dependency between these stages when you explain an application functionally, right? But when you map this to CPU cores, you could do that as a pipeline of CPU cores, you could do that as a run-to-completion model, you could do that as a hybrid model. So different ways to architect your application. But which way is actually the best one? So it actually depends on the application. It depends on your resources that you have available, number of CPU cores, so on and so forth. It depends on how much basically on the CPU SKU, how much L3 cache you have, so on and so forth. It depends on the complexity of your application, because if you develop a routing stack, maybe you could actually do a very cumbersome, maybe run to completion model where you actually use semaphores and locks every time, similar to like the Linux network stack. I'm not saying the bad thing about it, but this is the way it's really done. It's like you have anybody can do anything on any packet at any given time. So basically, every time you do something, you need to stop and ask for permission. It's like, can I go down the bed? Can I go down? Can I open the water? Can I close the water tap? Can I? Everything, you need to ask for permission, because maybe somebody is doing the same thing at the same time. Can I use the soap? No, I'm done with the soap. Maybe somebody else can use it. So that's one way to do things. Another way is to kind of have a run-to-completion model where you actually separate, avoid locks by separating, splitting a big table, big application tables into smaller chunks, and each core is using a different portion of the big table. Or you could have pipelines, or you could have hybrid models, or you could have any topology. So this is what we try to do here. We try to make sure that we can connect these functional blocks that are pipelines or tasks or whatever in any topology. And we want to investigate and find out which is the best topology for a given application, given topology of pipelines, which is the best mapping to CPU cores, which is the most efficient way to do that. So the good thing is that in order to do this, our API, basically our interfaces of this block allow us to do that. Because packet queues allow you to, we don't care what you have inside, as long as your inputs are packet queues and outputs are packet queues, which could be different types of software queues or KNI queues or tab or whatever, you can simply connect them together. A software queue, which is an RT ring, could actually be used as an output packet queue for one pipeline and an input packet queue for the next one. So basically, when you design these blocks, you don't have to think how you are going to use them, in which topology. You don't care. You simply design your block and you optimize each block independently. So basically, that's the first step here. As long as your functional blocks, your tasks, are built using this interface of packet queues, of queues really, on input and output, you can connect them in any configuration. And then the first step is basically build your application, build all the pipelines you need, and connect them together in like a straightforward topology, like a very simple pipeline. Just throw each pipeline on a different CPU core. Focus on optimizing each block, focus on functional correctness, don't focus on application overall performance at this point. So that's the first stage. What you have on the top of the screen. Then the second stage is you try to squeeze down the number of CPU cores that you use. Because typically throwing each pipeline to a different CPU core is not going to be optimal in terms of performance. Why is that? Because of the core-to-core transfer cost. So then, how do you do that? Well, you are going to try different things. So you are going to say, okay, I have these five pipelines, for example. How do I map five pipelines to one physical core? Well, it's actually not one combination, because a physical core has two hyperthreads. So it's actually two logical cores. How do you map five small boxes on two big boxes? You have a number of combinations. I think it's actually 32. Obviously, it doesn't depend, the hyperthreads are identical, so whether you have pipelines 0, 1, and 2 on hyperthread 0 and 3 and 4 on hyperthread 1 is actually the same as reverting the hyperthreads, having 3 and 4 on hyperthread 0 and the other ones on hyperthread 1. It's the same thing, right, because hyperthreads are identical. So when you do this investigation and you basically go through this brute force process of testing all these configurations, you have to, it's probably a good idea to eliminate the duplicates, right? Because you'll save time. So then what are you looking for? You are looking for that combination. So you're going to try out combinations to map basically all the pipelines to one physical core with two hyperthreads. Then you go to two physical cores with four hyperthreads in total. Then to three physical cores with six hyperthreads, so on and so forth. You need to stop at some point, and you need to kind of decide which is what are you looking for. So you are looking for what you are looking for is actually not the straightforward application throughput metric, because I'll give you an example. You might do 5 million packets per second with one physical core, mapping everything to one physical core. Or you might do 7.5. Yeah, you might do, let's say, 7 million with two cores, right? So then which one is better? It's actually this metric of performance per physical core, right? It's not just performance. Because if you can do 7 million with one core and 5 million with two cores, sorry, the other way around, 5 million with one core, 7 million with two cores. Although you do 7 million with two cores, it's higher, but you can actually do 5 million with one core and take another core and do 5 more millions, just instantiate the application again on the second core. So then you do 2 times 5, which is 10 million, which is more than 7. So basically, you are looking to maximize this performance per physical core. It's not per number of hyperthreads, you don't care. It's about physical cores, because a hyperthread is just one side, one part of a physical core, and it's the physical core that matters. So you will go through this brute force process. You will basically get the throughput of the application, you'll compute this metric, and then you will actually pick the one that has the best performance. And when do you stop? When you see that adding another core will not help you, will not give you more performance. So then the last step is actually to replicate this golden configuration several times using different sets of CPU cores. And basically you run multiple application instances on different CPU cores. And this is how you scale up performance. When do you stop? When you run out of CPU cores, when you hit like some global limit of the CPU, like cache bandwidth, memory bandwidth, size of your last level cache or whatever. Yeah. So yeah, that's a lengthy topic. As I said, I think I managed to get through the basic idea. Now let's go to the VPP side, and Jasinder will talk about how we did this work. And what's our ongoing work to implement this use case into Cisco VPP, and which are our findings, which are the gaps that we saw, and what are we planning to do next?
So, yeah. So right now what Christian has discussed has been implemented in DPDK. So as an effort to implement the edge router into VPP framework, we have done some investigation and found some functional gaps. So one of the critical functions which was missing in VPP framework was egress traffic management, which is very critical component of the downstream path. So what we have done here is we have enabled this functionality in VPP framework. For that we have leveraged DPDK QoS library, which implements Hierarchical Scheduler in this traffic manager block. So I won't go into the detail of what are the configuration parameters, architecture of the Hierarchical Scheduler. There is a comprehensive documentation on dpdk.org. So you can go to next. So this is what we have done in VPP framework to enable the egress traffic management. So on the right, left side is this configuration file. So in order to enable the QoS functionality to any output interface, we have to enable some of the parameters in the configuration files. So first important parameter is enabling this HQoS flag with the interface to which we want to enable this functionality. And the second important thing is these HQoS objects run on a separate thread than the worker thread. So these threads are affinitized to the separate L cores, which are defined in the CPU section using L core list HQoS thread parameters. So once these are defined and we run the VPP application, QoS will be enabled on the interfaces which we have enabled in our applications. So as we see here in this diagram, this shows the high level technical implementation of the work which we have submitted in VPP. So we can see here the HQoS objects run on a separate thread than the worker threads. And when these HQoS objects are enabled, worker threads, instead of sending packets to the NIC queues, they write their packets to the software queues. So since worker threads implements the routing functions, so it is necessary that each worker threads connects to all the HQoS objects, because routing function can route the packets to any one of these interfaces. So in that case, when the HQoS receives the packet, Here, the thread can run multiple HQoS objects, where each HQoS object could be associated with different type of output interfaces. So when the thread runs, it runs the HQoS threads installed on it in a round robin fashion, scan all the software queue of that that belongs to the HQoS threads and fetch that packet, and then enqueue into the HQoS objects and dequeue it. And then forward it to the and apply some egress traffic management on the HQoS object and then transfer it to the output interface. So that's the high level overview of the work. There are more technical implementation, but we won't go it here because time is getting over. So yeah, thank you. Any questions?
Any quick questions?
Yeah.
It's part of DPDK. Yes, we did, and it's part. It's released to DPDK.
Okay, including MPLS imposition on the PE.
Including what?
MPLS. When your application you showed there had an MPLS label in there. So how did you do that? Just using DPDK, or is that in there now?
Yes. So basically, everything that I said is part of DPDK, and it's part of. The IP pipeline application, though, if you just run the IP pipeline application, loading those configuration files, you'll get exactly what we talked about. Yeah.
So my question is about the brute force process that you mentioned. So I don't think it's really brute force, is it? Because one thing that comes to my mind is that you just run the pipeline and see which core is a bottleneck. Right? Maybe there are other ways to figure out what's the best layout. I mean, mapping from the pipeline stages to the cores.
Yeah, sometimes you can apply, the baseline is a brute force process, but obviously you can eliminate some of the combinations by actually, if you know your application and you know your specifics of the application, you could probably say, okay, that combination is probably not going to be successful. There is no sense to run those 10 combinations. Yeah, go ahead.
So you can apply any heuristic like in the beginning of the process, and then you apply sequential process by increasing the cores and mapping those function blocks accordingly in a sequence. So you can start with some heuristic in the beginning.
All right, but it's the measurement that you, how can you evaluate that? By just seeing what's the throughput per core on each, for each part of the pipeline, or do you gather other metrics too?
Well, so you could actually put multiple pipelines on the same CPU core. So sometimes, you know some of them are a bottleneck, so you can probably, as part of your initial stage, so then you can actually add more of those pipelines, more instances of those pipelines. You could actually tweak this brute force process, optimize it, reduce some of the combinations. Yeah, but you need to know your application. This is kind of a generic methodology that will just lead you to the right conclusion without actually thinking too much about the application itself. But obviously, thinking about the application will help you to expedite the process, right?
Okay, thanks.
Yeah. Okay, do you assume that processing for one packet is independent for another packet? So it may be true of like L3 processing. Like if you do a packet forwarding, maybe each packet processes independent of each other. But if you look at the higher level, like if you want to run stateful firewalls that keeps track of the flows, like all the packets that belong to the one connect has to go to the same location to be processed.
Yes.
And then there might be another constraint.
Yes.
Where if you want to enforce some relationship between the different connections, I want to see all the packets that belong to this connections. How do you actually, can you actually express that constraint in your framework?
Yeah, so what we do is everything is based on burst of packets. All the pipelines process burst of packets. It's not just one packet at a time. And everything is in the flow context, at least in this example, right? So think about the upstream, you do flow classification first, and then you get the flow ID, and then when you go to the metering stage, you apply the processing based in the context of the flow. So for each flow ID, you get a different context. So simply by doing classification, you can go through.
Is the classification happening in the software, or do you actually use some of the hardware, like RSS type of?
So we can actually do both things. Maybe if you go to the second slide, please. There is also a section here, as we have sections for pipelines and mempools. We also have sections for links, like the physical ports, and then you can enable RSS or flow direct or whatever features you have. So you can use the hardware features to help with the classification and the flow processing, or you can actually do software flow classification using this pipeline. Make sense?
And you can actually specify the relationship between the different flows.
Absolutely, everything is in the flow context. If it would
I'm not talking about the one packets in the same flow. Talk packets from in the different flows. I want to see process all the packets that are related. For example, like HTTP requests that are related to the one site, right?
Yeah, you can affinitize. You can affinitize flows. You can have forward and reverse flows that could go to the same core, or they could go to different cores depending on what you decide.
You can write the code in software
based on your hashing schemes once for sorry.
Q&Q and DPLS, are they supported in the NIC driver or software in software?
So when we started doing this work, everything was software based. We couldn't use too many NIC features, but I think going forward with some of the Intel NICs, maybe other NICs as well from other vendors, you can actually do more of this. You can push it to the NIC, like stripping MPLS or QNQ labels, or prepending these labels.
The metering, you were talking about 7 and 5 megapackets per second. They were reached by software implementation?
Metering is done in software, traffic management is done in software, so all the QoS stuff is done in software. Because, to be honest, we couldn't use too many unique features at this point. Hopefully, going forward, we'll improve on that side. And the more we can push to hardware, the better, right? Save CPU cores for other things.
Okay, folks.
maybe last question from Machi.
I'll give you one.
Thank you.
Do you have any sample performance numbers for both downstream and upstream for something that is, you know, the combination of features is quite realistic, so some realistic configuration?
Yes, we do have some numbers that we generated internally, and most of them we keep them internally. To publish performance numbers outside, we need to go through a very rigorous process. So we didn't want to take this pain. But to be honest, anybody can do that, and as part of the CC project, we can do that. So we can basically automate that, so anybody could actually push a button and get the numbers.
Right, it would be good to have at least some expectations, specifically for the traffic manager piece, which is, you know, queuing, shaping, very compute-intensive operations.
I knew you were going to say that.
So just, it would be good
I agree, it's just that there is a little...
To at least get some indication, because, you know, coding those tests clearly takes time and resource, and the application itself looks very attractive.
Yeah, I agree. Thank you.
Okay. Christian, Jasvinder, thank you very much. We'll have to keep things moving along. Thanks, guys.